morning, everyone. Carol here at Oak House Journals, and we're on week 35, I believe, of the 52 Tags Handmade project. Sorry if I've got that week wrong. I'm a bit out of sync at the moment. I've been away for a few days doing a basket weaving course, and I just feel out of sync with everything. So apologies if I've got that wrong, but I think I'm right. And also apologies about my hands. they're kind of a bit sore and worse for wear, with a few blisters and whatever from doing the basket weaving. But I had a brilliant time, and now I'm ready to get on with my piece for this week. Now, the prompt for this week was a piece of fabric that was much loved that we had been hoarding, and buttons. Well, I don't really have any fabric in my stash that I hoard. Everything that I have, I know what I'm going to use it for, or I have an intended purpose for it. But that being said, I have this piece of fabric that came in my stocking last Christmas, and I absolutely love it. It's quite a good size piece, double-sided, as you can see, but I absolutely love it. And I did have this piece set to one side with every intention of making a journal cover out of it, but I'm not going to need all of this. And for what project I have in mind today with those prompts, I can spare a little bit of this, and I absolutely love it. So I think that qualifies as something that is much loved. I'm making three of these little projects because they're quick and easy. So I have another piece of vintage fabric. Now, this was destined for one of my Amity Bloom journals to be used in that journal, and it will be used in that journal, but it's a gorgeous piece of vintage fabric, so I will be using that. And I also have this little piece of trim here, which I love, and I think I will probably use this. I'm not too sure. I want to see what it looks like. I only have this piece, so I will only be able to trim one side of this fabric with it, and it might not give me the right sort of look for the project I have in mind. So if it doesn't look quite right, then I won't be using that piece. So that's my second piece. And my third piece is this gorgeous, gorgeous piece of trim here. And I've had this in my stash again to be used in my Amity Bloom journals. But I was going to use this in my blue journal because I'm making three. Needless to say, couldn't make one. I had to make three of the Artists in Bloom journals. So I'm making two pink and one blue. So I had this one to one side in the project box to do something with in that journal. So I'm going to be using that. And for my backing fabric, I'm going to be using this, or part of this piece of fabric. Now, this is a piece of an old pillowcase, and the rest of it I used for my rusted fabrics. It's much loved pillowcase, but as you can see, it's seen better days. But I just love the quality of the cotton. So I've used it a lot, as you can see, and this is just a piece that I had left over. So I'm going to be using this long piece from the back. If I can just pull that apart, give it a quick snip there. So I'm going to be using this long piece from the back to back, use as my backing piece for that piece of trim there. So I've got three projects in mind, as I say, three all identical, using these pieces. I haven't chosen any buttons as yet. I'm going to cross that bridge when I come to it. I'm sure I can find suitable buttons. But as I say, this is a quick, easy project. I'm just going to make some magnetic bookmarks for those little journals. So I'm going to go away first off and give everything a good press. And then I'm going to cut myself some strips about that wide, which is probably about an inch and a quarter, maybe, yeah, about an inch and a quarter. And I'm going to be stitching them down the side and putting a point at each end. So this one I've just pressed and I've turned in a fold, and I'm just going to trim along the edge like so. This piece I'll keep and I'll use in the rest of the journal. And now what I'm going to do with this is just turn in a slight edge on either side like so, and then again give it another press. So I'm getting about an inch in diameter across the width, and in terms of length, this is the perfect length. The journals are not very big, so we're looking at 6.5 inches here, and the bottom edge I will taper, bottom and top edge I will taper. So that's what I'm going to do on that one. I'm going to press those sides in. I'm ready to sew, and there's my edging strip. What I've done with this piece is, or this blue fabric, is I've just chopped out a piece ripped a piece along the edge of my fabric. I've taken the selvage edge because what I will do is I will use that as my fold in. I've also just folded it on the other side, and again that will be my bookmark with a pointed end there and a pointed end down here. So I've obviously got way too much fabric or fabric length here. So what I'm going to do is just use this strip as a measure and chop it off across the bottom there. And that will be my bookmark, and I've not cut that straight true to form. Not particularly a problem with tapering the edge. So I've got my other piece there, and I will give that another bit of a press. And this one I will use in the journal as well, along with this will be used as my cover, but I will use this in the Amity Bloom journal so that later on it picks up the continuity of colour throughout. So that's those pieces. And then this one is going to be wider for the simple reason that this trim is wide. I think this must be about a 2 inch, it's about 1 3/4, just over 1 3/4 from the widest part. Now I love this and I don't want to lose that edge down either side. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open out my pillowcase because, as I say, this is going to be my backing fabric on here. I could leave it like that, but I don't want any rough edges. When I turn the bottom to create that point, I don't want any rough edges along the bottom and on the reverse. So I pretty much want to have that backed, I think. But actually, looking at it, I could probably get away. That's interesting. I could probably get away if I just neaten up this bottom edge slightly, because it's quite detailed and there's a lot of overlocking on the trim. I could probably get away with it actually looking pretty neat on the back, depending on how I sew it. And actually, yeah, change of plan, everybody. I think I am just going to leave this as it is without a backing on. So this piece of fabric, as much as I love it, it will come in useful in another project, without a doubt. But I'm just going to go away, neaten up those edges better, and just press them over to make my point like that. And then I'm ready for decorating my bookmark, because I'm actually going to leave this pretty simple. I might do some embroidery if I can do it neat enough so that when I take my bookmark off, it's not going to show too much of my reverse stitching. But what I can do with that is I can actually have a look and see what it looks like with my reverse stitching in place. And then if it's too messy for my liking, then I can always go back in with this and back it. But as it stands at the moment, I think that is pretty nice, actually. I think you're probably seeing white on, well, you are seeing white on white, everybody. So that's probably not looking anything special to you, but it actually looks quite nice. And it's ending on, or the point is coming on either side of a daisy. So I could stitch a little button in there and that would look perfect. With this piece, I've decided that I want both ends to look the same. And as you saw before, it folds nicely and gives me a point where that flower is. So as this one, the flower has been chopped off the bottom, what I'm going to do is I'm going to level it up with this one so that I can see roughly where to give it a snip and cut it in more or less the same place, so it looks like it's across from this scallop on the bottom here, like so, and that'll give me my point there. And then this was the side that I just wanted to neaten up a little bit, just so that I can get a nice fold and a nice seam on the other side. So again, I'm not throwing that out. I'll use that as decoration in another part of my projects. And then I'm just going to press that in place to get that lovely point. And I'm going to do that on either side. So this is what it looks like now with those pieces just pressed. Whoops-a-daisy. Just pressed in place. So I'm really happy with how that looks. And now what I plan to do is just do a little hand stitch down there just to hold that edge in place. And I'm still going to leave this open because I need to put my magnet in there. So I'm going to do that with this one, but I want to get the other two to the same stage. So what I've done is, as you can see, I've done my pressing and I've got my seams inside on both of these two pieces. This one is a little bit wide, so I'm just going to trim it down, just eyeballing roughly how much I need. Okay, so to create the points, all I've done is I've taken my piece of fabric and I've put it right side in and just reverse that fold along the edge and then popped a pin in. And I've done that top and bottom. Just like so. There we go. Pop a pin in. And then, working with your width of fabric, not this bit here where you've got the crease, all I've done is I've measured across the bottom, ignoring my turning piece, to find the center point, which is roughly here. Then I've measured half an inch from the bottom and put a little mark. And I've done the same along the crease on the other side and put a little mark. And then all I've done is joined up my dots so that it gives me a line. Now I'm working graphite pencil. I was working with the erasable marker pen, but as soon as I was drawing my line, it was disappearing. So I'm working with a graphite pencil. I'm not bothered at all that it's going to leave a mark, for the simple reason that we're working on the inside of the fabric and it's not going to be shown. So as you can see, I've drawn up a point in there and I've done the same on my pink fabric here. It stands out a little bit better, as you can see, so I thought I would do that, show you that one. And I'm just very quickly going to mark up the bottom. Now you can make your points as sharp or as shallow as you like. I've just kind of gone with what looks comfortable to me, to the eye, and I'm working with that. So that's my line there. And again, my line on the other side. Now what I'll do is I'll show you on this one because it's clearer. I will take this away now to the sewing machine, and you could sew this by hand. I'm just for speed for this week, I'm doing mine on the sewing machine. I'm going to be stitching on the machine along that line and that line, and then I'm going to come all the way up that crease here to about a third of the way up, and then I'm going to do a back stitch and stop. And then I'm going to do the same at the bottom. I'm going to stitch from there to there to there, and then up the crease here to about a third, do a back stitch and stop. And that will give me a gap in my seam, and that will help me when I come to turn the fabric the right side out and to help me get those points nice and sharp. So I'm going to go away and do that now. So these are my two pieces that I've stitched on the machine, as you can see. And I've left a little gap in the middle there. So all I'm going to do now is obviously take out my pins. I've done back stitches where I've finished my machine stitching, so I can just snip off those threads quite happily and nothing's going to happen. My stitches are all going to be secure in place, like so. Pop that one to one side. Now all I'm going to do is I'm still going to leave this edge here, but I'm going to trim it down closer to my machine stitching. And round here where my points are, I'm going to trim away there as well. So that, let me do it on this side, and I hope you can see better where I've stitched over my pencil mark. So I'm going to snip very close, but not on my stitching, but very close to my stitching, which will mean that that is going to make it easier for me when I turn that point to the other side. So I've just do this side as well. And as I say, I'm just going to trim down those seams again. But use the correct scissors rather than my embroidery scissors. So, and I'm going to do that on both of these, and then I'm going to turn them right sides out and give them a press. These are what my pieces look like now that they've been turned right side out, and I've used the point of my scissors and a bone folder to try and push up into those peaks or points. And as you can see, there is still a gap here at the side that I've left open after pushing those points through. And the reason that I've done that is so that I could put some magnets in each point. Now I've done that with this one, and I've just got a little tiny magnet, and I'll show you which ones I've used. These are some just basic magnets that I got off Amazon. They're about 5 millimeters across by a millimetre in thickness. Now, I usually use smaller than these in my journals when I need to use a magnet, but these are ideal for this sort of project. So if I just pop that one down there, what I've done is, using that gap at the side, I just dropped a magnet in each point, just checked that they would connect, and then using Invisifil, this applique thread, if you watch my channel, you'll have seen I've been using this all the time for all sorts of projects. I just put a couple of little stitches at the end, because once the magnet is pushed down into that corner, it's not going to move anywhere if you put a little stitch just there to hold it in place. And that's what I've done. And as you can see, I've got my connection there on my bookmark. So what I'll do now with this one is I will just do a little stitch all the way along the end to close that gap up, and then decorate this. Now, let me just show you. All I did was I got one of the magnets, opened up my little pocket, dropped one in, let it go right down to the bottom, and you have to kind of tease it down with your thumb, and it's there sitting in the bottom corner now, or in that bottom point. Then I got another one and I just dropped it on top. I'm going to move these two out of the way because I don't want the magnets from those interfering with what I'm doing now. So now I know that that is the right side for the connection. I'm just very carefully picking it up, opening up my gap, and I'm putting it inside, but I'm making sure that it is still oriented in the right direction, and I'm just teasing it down to the bottom point, and it's down and in there now. Just going to have a feel, because these are very, very fine. It's quite hard to feel them if your fabric is too thick. So I know now, I can feel it, it's down in that top point and this one's down there. So I'm hanging on to them at the moment, but I'm just checking that they're going to, and it's flipped over whilst it was working its way down. So now what I have to do is just gently bring it back up. Get hold of it and gently flip it over. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and align it again. So there we go, I've got it again. I'm going to put it down very carefully inside, and as I say, just tease it down to the bottom with my finger. Okay, so it's down at the bottom again. I'm just going to pinch it at the bottom so that I know it's still sat there. And that one's pinched at the bottom here, and I can feel that they are the right way around, that they're going to connect when I sew those in place. And that's all I did to make sure that my magnets were seated in there properly. So I will go ahead and do that with those in a moment. Now, with this one, all I did with this one was, when I folded over my fabric, I put my magnet literally in the centre of this little flower here, but on the reverse. And then again, using the Invisifil, I very, very carefully did almost like a spider's web of stitching over the top to hold the magnet in place. And then I stitched this triangle that I created by folding the lace back in place, and I did the same on the other side. Now, to do that webbing was a little bit of a challenge, but I didn't want to use glue and I didn't want to use double-sided tape. Had it been a paper project, then I would have most definitely have used double-sided tape, because I find that works brilliantly. Glue can be a little bit of a hit and miss for me, because, as you know, if you get any glue on the connecting surface of your magnets, they won't work. So I prefer to use double-sided tape. But with this being lace or fabric, I didn't want to do that. So I did that little web, if you will, with the invisible thread. It, as I say, was a little bit of a challenge because the magnets are so small, I really had to pinch it hard to hold it in place as I sewed over the top. And if I didn't pinch it hard enough, it flipped onto the needle. But once I got two or three threads going across it, it was fine after that. And now I have this little thing that is my bookmark, and it's happy. Even though I've got a double thickness because there's two thicknesses of fabric there where they cross over and have been stitched in place, it is still working quite nicely. And I have tested it over a piece of paper. So if I bring in a little piece of paper, then line them up. It's not a strong magnet, this one, unfortunately. It's all that I had, but it's enough to do the job. And as you can see, it's holding, if I turn it upside down, it's holding it nicely in place on either side of my paper. So it's going to be holding well in my Amity Bloom journals. Now that I have the magnet, certainly in two of them, these two, I need to decide now how I'm going to decorate. For this one, I thought that I would use these little ones, and these are, again, same as these, contemporary buttons, but these are white ones, and I thought that I would do just three like that. I am tempted to see whether or not I can put a jump ring through the bottom there and maybe have one hanging off the bottom and one like that, and one like that. I don't know. I'll see if I... Oh, actually, thinking about it, I won't be able to do that because I've got my magnet pushed right down into that bottom corner. So I doubt if I've got enough fabric. I could possibly, to put a jump ring through there, I could possibly do it with thread. I don't know. I'll see how that works. But I certainly plan to use two, if not three, on there. And as I said, I'm just keeping these very, very simple. And then with this one, being careful to how I'm flipping it over so I don't dislodge those magnets, again, I just thought that I would just use a single one of these and try and pick up the pink flowers. So these are my finished bookmarks. I've just put them on a piece of wallpaper just so that you can see how they're going to look when they're on at the top of a page in a journal. This one I did some random stitching on, just for the pure love of wanting to stitch on this fabric. So I just picked out one or two places and did some stem stitch along the stems of the plants. Put a few little seed beads on and did some French knots. I put a flower button at each end and went for the pearly white, and as you can see, I also put one at the bottom. Now, I didn't have enough room to put an eyelet in the bottom, didn't want to just thread my jump ring through, so what I actually did was just use some of the blue thread, embroidery thread, and attached it to my point with that, and then as you can see, I've just hung a little button. This one I've left very plain because the fabric really speaks for itself. Did exactly the same thing with the buttons at either end and also with the dangle on the bottom. If you wanted, you instead of matching the polarity of your magnet so that they stick like that, if you reverse the polarity, then effectively what you would get is something like that, magnetized at the bottom peaks, and you could put that portion there. If you flattened it slightly, you could put the corner of your page. That would need pressing, but you could have a dangle or a bookmark that actually went across the corner of your page, something like that, if that's what you fancied. So that's those two, and this one, I didn't add any buttons on this one at all. I thought it looked pretty decorative as it was. What I did do though was I added seed beads up the centre in each of those little daisies. I did some straight stitching all the way up on either side of this braid here. So there is a line just going up there and on the inside, and obviously on both sides. Then I followed the design of these sort of scrolls here all the way up in straight stitch. And then I went round the centre portion of each with a little bit of stem stitch. And because I've used a variegated thread, it's given me a touch of colour on it. So I'm quite pleased with that. It still stayed looking delicate and it wasn't too bad on the back either, which I was quite pleased about. In fact, I actually like the back better, but there we go. So those are my three pieces for this week. These two certainly hit the prompt in terms of much loved pieces of fabric with buttons. I've got that one round the wrong way, haven't I? And they've all got their, these two certainly have got their three buttons on. This one, well, it was just a lovely piece of trim that I wanted to play with. So thank you so much, everybody, for watching. And until the next video, have a fantastic week. Take care. Bye-bye.